And let's now talk to Renato Reyes, who's back. He's the Secretary General of the Bagong Alyansang Makabayan. So again, why do you think they disallowed the protest for tomorrow's SONA, or at least until UP Diliman? And do you believe that the ban is a good public health measure for physical distancing amid the pandemic?
Well, I think the last-minute changes, the last-minute ban on protest actions is really a desperate attempt to stop people from going out. I think they're very afraid that a lot of people might be joining the protests tomorrow, not just in Quezon City, but in all parts of the Philippines and all major urban centers. And I think people are upset, and rightly so, because in the middle of a pandemic, the government has chosen to prioritize measures that do not address the most urgent needs of the people, jobs, health, and so on. So despite the good relations that we have established with the police, we've talked to them, we've talked to the LGUs, we've talked to all concerned agencies, here comes the DILG at the last minute, Friday, the last working day, telling all the LGUs you can't issue permits, that's not allowed, and the rallies should not push through. And we think that's very, very wrong. It was intentional. They wanted to sabotage the protest actions, but unfortunately for them, the groups held a press conference this morning and announced that we're going to push through with the planned protest on Monday at UP Diliman.
Mm-hmm. So how many might be attending that protest action in UP Diliman? And do you think that they see, basically, they're just moving the protests from 3 kilometers away from Batasang Pambansa to now 9 kilometers away. Do you think that they might be seeing a physical risk to President Duterte's attendance of SONA?
I don't think the protesters posed any threat, physical threat to the president. We are so far away. We even chose in front of the Commission on Human Rights. That was the original venue. So we don't see that as posing any credible threat to the president. I think what they're threatened right now is the number of people speaking out. They're more threatened with people being emboldened to protest because of what's going on around their country. It's not true that they're looking after our public health, because the protest actions that we have held the past few weeks already observed physical distancing. Everybody wore face masks. We followed the correct health protocols, as opposed to what we're seeing now in Rizal Coliseum under the watch of the DILG. You know, people are cramped inside in a coliseum and they're not practicing physical distancing. So you see, there's a huge difference between what the government is doing and what the protesters are doing. And I think the protesters are responsible enough to ensure that the health interests of the participants would be upheld, you know, at all times.
Would you say that IATF guidelines are being weaponized as law during this pandemic? And when was the last time you've heard of protests being banned? What do you think this means for freedom of assembly and freedom of speech in the country?
Well, it's quite unfortunate that they have weaponized the IATF guidelines. They have used it as a tool, as a weapon to arrest people, to prevent people from speaking out, even over social media. They used the Bayanihan Act to apprehend people speaking on social media. They used the IATF guidelines and the laws on notifiable diseases to arrest people. So I think what they want is that they are taking advantage of the pandemic. They're taking advantage of the quarantine rules to silence people. And that is a very, very bad sign. That is a further drift towards the path of dictatorship. And that is something that we must not allow. That is why, despite all these IATF guidelines on prohibiting protest actions, we have chosen to speak out and to continue fighting. We have to push back, because if we allow them to weaponize the quarantine guidelines, then they would be able to establish some kind of dictatorship where everybody would be forced to follow and toe the line imposed by government.
Now, what are the most urgent issues right now? Which events of the past year have been the most upsetting for you? Would you discount the fact that we have one of the longest lockdowns in the world, since other countries may be encountering the same economic issues right now?
Well, I think the defining issue of this SONA rally would be the pandemic. This is the first time that the SONA protest would be held during a time of a great health crisis, a health emergency. So the COVID crisis would be on top of our list, and the economic crisis that it has resulted in. So the joblessness, the closing of businesses, the lack of economic aid, those would be critical issues that will be discussed on Monday. And then we go through the issues that have been prioritized by the administration. Instead of focusing on health and the economy, the administration focused on the anti-terror law, the shutdown of ABS-CBN. Now they're pushing for charter change, and they have in the pipeline more policies that would be detrimental to the interests of the people. So these are the issues that would be discussed in the rally on Monday, though it would be a shortened rally, the shortened program, so as to minimize exposure of the participants. But we hope to be able to tackle all the relevant issues on July 27.
Mm-hmm. Have the issues changed in urgency since 2016 SONA? What is your grade for the president? And what do you think would bring it to 10 over 10 in this time of pandemic?
Well, the urgency is there because of the pandemic. We are in the worst economic crisis in recent history. There's no slowing down as far as the infections are concerned. The new cases are piling up, the backlogs in testing and validation are piling up. So these would create bigger problems down the road. No? We are already in a recession, and the government has so far not offered any viable solution to address the health crisis and the economic crisis. I don't see any scenario right now where the president would get a passing grade after what has happened. I mean, just look at the DOH, Secretary Duque is still there despite all the questionable issuances that he has made, despite all the questionable statements that he has made. That's symptomatic of how the mismanagement of the crisis is being done. And I think people would rather express outrage at this point. No? Hindi na po natin maaasahan na makakabawi pa eh dun sa passing grade. No? I think we're past that. People are upset, people are indignant, and they want people to be held accountable.
So in which case, if there is no way for him to recover from a low grade, then what is the solution right now?
Well, the solution is for people to push the agenda for health, agenda for the economy. The solution is for those in power to start listening to the demands of the people and stop prioritizing their own narrow interests. No? We've seen that in the case of ABS-CBN, for example. The overwhelming public opinion was to renew the franchise, but the politicians preferred to listen to their own narrow interests, and that can't be the way we're going. If we're going to survive the pandemic, we can't continue down that path. So it's time that the government listen to the people and steer the country in a different direction.
And now we're also seeing moves for charter change. Do you see this as might be affecting democracy in the last year of the president?
Well, charter change is probably the last thing that we need right now. There's zero clamor for charter change. Nobody's really asking for it. Only the politicians are asking for it. Maybe there's some manufactured clamor made by the DILG to push for it. But it is something that should not be entertained right now. We have bigger problems. And if we push for charter change, then we may create a scenario where power is concentrated in the hands of a few ruling elite, and the people would be in a much worse place than they were before. So we have to oppose it. We have to stop, you know, those politicians who are pushing for term limit, term extensions, removal of term limits. These are all self-serving measures. No? Why do we need to lift term limits right now? Why do we need to give politicians an unlimited number of terms? It doesn't make sense. It will not solve the pandemic. It will not solve the economic crisis.
Renato Reyes of the Bagong Alyansang Makabayan, thank you so much for joining us today and sharing your thoughts with us.